Welcome to Victory Baptist Worship, recorded live from the campus of Victory Baptist Church in Mount Juliet, Tennessee. We're excited you've chosen to watch this episode on our Roku channel and invite you to watch our live streaming events on our Facebook page as well as on our website. At the conclusion, we'll give you more information on how to better connect with Victory Baptist Church. As you prepare for this week's message, grab your Bible and follow along as we join this week's episode of Victory Baptist Worship.
This is sort of a Christmas type of song, and yet it talks about the fact that we serve a great God, and it's the greatest story that's ever been told, so we can tell the story all year round.
Listen. Amen.
A woman and an angel, a promise and a song, a word too grand for any mind to hold. A tax law and a journey, a stable and some straw. Tell the greatest story ever told.
Oh,
Amen. Thank you, choir. Our offertory hymn this morning, "The Church is One Foundation in Jesus Christ, Her Lord." Let's stand and sing our offertory.
The church is one foundation in Jesus Christ, her Lord. She is his new creation by Spirit and the Word. From heaven he came and sought her to be his holy bride. With his own blood he bought her, and for her life he died. Elect from every nation, yet one o'er all the earth, her charter of salvation, one Lord, one faith, one one holy name she blesses, and shares one holy food, and to one hope she presses with every grace endued. Mid toil and tribulation and tumult of her consummation of peace forevermore, till with a vision glorious her longing eyes are blessed at the great church victorious shall be the church.
Father God, we're thankful for this opportunity, Lord, to gather together again, Lord, to worship you. Lord, we thank you for the many ways you show your love to us, the blessings you pour out on us every day. Lord, we thank you for this time that we can give back a portion of that that you've so richly blessed us with. Lord, multiply it, use it for the furtherance of thy kingdom. It's in Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Let's sing the chorus together.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
One of the most faithful piano players that has ever been is Miss Betty Stewart. Thank you, Miss Betty. And I do have to say the same for Miss Pat. Thank you, Pat. I'd like to sing this as a special request, and I pray that it blesses you. I've sung it many times, and I've sung it at many funerals, but I still love the words. It is well with my soul.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul. My sin, oh, the bliss of that glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole, was nailed to that cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. And Lord, haste the day when my faith shall be signed. The trump shall resound, and my Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well. It
So thank you for giving consideration and prayer to that. Now let's turn to the scripture, John chapter 14. It is important that we come to this time, and as we consider what we have just shared with you, that we look at the passage in John 14, verse 27 and following, where Jesus speaks of the peace that he provides, that he leaves, that he gives. Not peace as the world gives, but peace that only he can provide for us. Would you stand with me as we give a place of honor to the reading of God's word this morning? John 14, beginning at verse 27. Jesus said, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give you as the world gives. Don't let your hearts be troubled or fearful. You have heard me tell you I am going away and I am coming to you. If you love me, you would rejoice that I am going to the Father, because the Father is greater than I. I have told you now before it happens, so that when it does happen, you may believe. I will not talk with you much longer, because the ruler of the world is coming. He has no power over me. On the contrary, so that the world may know that I love the Father, I do as the Father commanded me. Get up, let's leave this place." May God add his richest blessing to the reading of his word. Thank you. Please be seated. One of the leading voices in the teaching of leadership in America has made this comment: "You can buy a person's hands, but you cannot buy their heart. Their heart is where their enthusiasm and their loyalty rest." I want to say to all of us this morning that Jesus neither came to buy your hands nor to buy your heart. Rather, Jesus came to rescue your heart from a state of troubledness and fear. Jesus came to win your heart and to win your trust. That's why the scripture says that he stands at the door of our heart and he knocks. And if we will open, he will come in. The scripture reminds us that we are to give our heart to him. It is your trust in Jesus that allows him not to buy your heart, but to buy your freedom. The freedom from sin, the freedom from the penalty of sin, the freedom from the power of sin in your life. And the scripture here focuses and helps us understand that as Jesus speaks again into the lives of his disciples, as he speaks into our lives, he repeats what he says in the first verse of this chapter when he says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not be fearful, for I have come to give you peace." It's interesting that in Jeremiah 17:9, that the scripture records for us that the heart is more deceitful than anything else. It is hard to understand. But when Jesus speaks into our lives and he brings truth into our lives, he speaks of ministering to our hearts. Not just this place here in the center of our chest, but into the very being, the very core of who we are. When Jesus speaks peace, and he tells us in his language that he has come to give us peace, to leave his peace with us, it's important that we recognize that it is his gift to us. And he speaks into our lives in the midst of all that is troubling. For he is not denying the fact that we live in a world that is oftentimes chaotic, that is oftentimes disruptive, that is also oftentimes discouraging. But he speaks to us of leaving peace. He speaks into our heart. And he reminds us of the words of the psalmist: "Commit your ways to the Lord, trust in him, and he will act, making your righteousness shine like the dawn." Commit your way. Trust him. Place your faith in Him. Allow Him to win the day in your heart. Therefore, your words and your thoughts might be honoring to Him, as the psalmist says in Psalm 19, verse 14, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing and acceptable to you, O Lord. I wonder this morning, as we prepare to gather here in this place, how many of us allowed our thoughts and our words to be pleasing to the Lord? The fact of the matter is, the evil one seeks to do everything and anything that he can to disrupt that moment when we connect with the Holy Spirit and allow the Holy Spirit to draw us to a place where we can celebrate the invitation that God has given to us to gather with his people so that we might minister to him through our worship and our praise. When we step aside from the world that demands our attention for just a few moments, where we can focus on the presence of Almighty God and know that what he says to us is that we might be still and acknowledge him as God, because we must not be fooled. We must know that he will be exalted among the nations whether we exalt him or not. And the real challenge for us in receiving the peace and allowing Jesus to win our hearts is to step aside from all of the hustle and bustle of our world for just a few moments as we gather here on a Sunday morning, as we sit quietly in his presence for a few moments of prayer and meditation on his word, and allow his word to begin to transform us, to bring us to a place where we can receive that peace that he leaves as his gift to us, a peace that causes us to recognize the fact that our hearts need not be troubled and we need not fear. For he has secured for us a peace that is beyond understanding in this world. It's a peace that comes as we seek to hide the word of God in our hearts so that we might not sin against him. It's a word that speaks into our hearts so that we would come to a place when we sit still before the Lord for just a few moments each and every day and cry out as the psalmist does in Psalm 139 and say, search me and try me, O Lord. Discover what's in my heart, what's truly in my heart, what's truly in the core of my being. Is the world running over me, or is the peace of the Lord flowing in and through me in my life? Jesus speaks to his disciples. He has just reminded them again that he's about to leave them, that he's going to die for them, that he's leaving and dying for us. And he speaks into their lives and says to them, peace, peace I'm leaving with you, my peace. He leaves his peace. So what is this peace really about? What does this peace provide for you and me in this world that is so often challenging us and filled with tribulation and trials? First of all, we need to understand that this peace that Jesus leaves to us is his gift to us. It's a gift that guards the heart and guards our mind. It is a certain peace. It's not the kind of peace that the world gives. We search, we long for, we work toward peace in the world. Let me just remind all of us that until we are at peace with God, we can neither be at peace with the world or the world at peace with us. Do we agree with that? The scripture speaks to us, Jesus speaks to us, that his peace that he gives, that he leaves with us, is a certain peace. It's an eternal peace. It's a peace that guards our heart. What does that mean? It means it guards the truth that God has placed in our hearts. Have we truly hid his word in our hearts, so that as we have hid his word in our heart, it would inspire, it would encourage, and it will guide us so that we might not sin against him, but rather be faithful in our obedience toward him. It is the gift that Paul helps us to understand in Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 through 7, when he says, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your graciousness be known to everyone, for the Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, through prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to the Lord God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Let me ask you today, how many of us have the assurance and the peace that passes all understanding that is guarding our hearts and our minds? I wonder how many in this room this morning, you're having a difficult time listening to what I'm saying because there's no peace as to whether or not the Titans will win today. Right? Now let's be serious about it. How many of us in this room may not find the peace that passes understanding guarding my heart and my mind because we're faced with a financial crisis? We're faced with a family crisis. We're faced with a health crisis. And right now, in this moment, there's fear and our hearts are troubled because we've not allowed the peace of the Lord to guard our hearts and to remind us of the word and the truth that has been sealed to our hearts to set us free. To know that we rest in the hands of Almighty God, and that if God watches over the sparrow, He certainly is watching over us. And He's ministering to us. This is why Paul, I believe, writes in Ephesians chapter 1, when he says to the people, to us, he's saying, Lord, open the eyes of their heart, enlighten their eyes, the eyes of their heart, to the great hope that is theirs in Jesus Christ. It's that hope that leads us to a place of peace. Yes, in this world we will have tribulation. We will face tribulation. Listen, Jesus faced tribulation every single day he walked on earth. And yet he walked in obedience and faithfulness to the Father, even unto death on a cross that is a curse to him, but the greatest blessing to us. It brings peace. It's peace that he leaves. He's not saying that we have to discover it, we have to find it. He says he leaves it for us. It's a little bit like the manna. They didn't have to go out searching for the manna. Every morning the manna was left for them on the ground in the wilderness. His peace he has left, and his peace is a gift. It's a gift that continues to lead us to face every challenge, every tribulation, every trial with the understanding that he wins and that he is our victory. And that we can have the assurance that brings peace to us, that in the end, he has a way and he has a purpose and he is working his purpose through all things in our lives for his good pleasure. Now that's a real challenge for us sometimes, isn't it? When we think about some of the challenges that we face. But we need to understand that his peace is his gift to us. Secondly, we see that his peace is also a fruit of the Spirit. Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 says this, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. What does that mean to us? It means that not only did he leave his peace with us, not only is his peace a gift, but his peace is working in our lives. And therefore, his advocate that we talked about 2 weeks ago, the Holy Spirit that he has provided us and asked the Father for us, is now at work producing not only love and joy, but his peace in us. His Holy Spirit is there not only to guide us, not only to remind us, not only to instruct us, not only to be our personal trainer, as we talked about last week, but he is producing peace in us. But the thing that we need to be reminded of is that it's only when we allow the Spirit of God to be at work producing that fruit in us. It's only when we remain in the vine, John 15, when we find ourselves being receptive to the work and the production of the Holy Spirit in our lives, so that we might be able to experience and to know, even in the midst of great challenges, the peace that passes all understanding. It's His gift to us. It's His purpose. It's His guidance. It's His direction for our lives. He's providing for us and producing that peace within us. And where does it come from? It comes from us allowing the Spirit of God to direct us to His Word. Because the Scripture reminds us in John chapter 8 that we will know the truth and the truth will set us free. Set us free from what? Set us free from the tribulations? No. But it will set us free from the chaos and from the fear and the tribulation that troubles our heart. We will have the assurance that He is watching over and He is providing and He is guiding us as He produces His peace within us. How is it that someone can face death itself and have the assurance of God's peace that directs them to a hope that is beyond hope in this life? How is that? Because God, through His Spirit, is at work bringing peace to us. Peace I leave with you. Peace I give to you. Not temporary peace. Not peace that comes because you think you have enough in the bank account. Not peace that comes because you think you have great job security. Not peace because you think all is well in your home. But peace because you know all is well with the Lord and you. All is right with you and the Lord. Can we truly bow before the Lord and pray as Jesus prayed, not my will, but your will be done, and in the midst of that have great peace and courage and know that His hour, your hour, has come? What was it that Jesus' hour brought? Jesus' hour brought the full measure of God's provision for His people. And our hour is an opportunity for us to join Jesus in His hour to bring honor and glory to the name of the Father who loved us, created us, breathed life into us, and has now redeemed our life through faith and trust in Jesus Christ. He has given us this peace and produces this peace so that we might bring honor and glory to Him. How is it that they have peace in the midst of this great trial in their lives? Because the trial does not consume them. The trial does not control them. Jesus consumes them, and the Father controls all in their lives. And we believe that He is indeed at work, producing good through all things that come our way, even in the midst of our greatest trials. Peace that He leaves and that He gives to us, the Scripture says, tears down all walls. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 14. Paul is talking about the wall of hostility that stood between the Jews and the Gentiles. And listen to what he says. For Jesus is our peace, who made both groups, Gentiles and Jews, one, and tore down the dividing walls of hostility. What are the walls of hostility in your life and in my life? Well, the walls of hostility in our lives are the sins and the consequences of sin. Hostility that brings great tribulation to us is the shame that comes as a result of our sin, the guilt that comes as a result of our sin, the fear that comes as a result of our sin, the deflection that we seek as a result of our sin, the blame that comes as a result of our sin, the the excuses that come as a result of our sin, and the hiding that we seek to do as a result of our sin. These are the walls that we erect, hoping that it will hide us from the Heavenly Father. And all the while, the Father is moving one brick after another so that He might reveal Himself to us and remind us of the great peace that He has offered through His Son, Jesus Christ. He is tearing down the walls of hostility. And His peace comes to bring peace to us. So important that we understand and that we embrace this peace that is ours as a result of who Jesus is and what He has done on our behalf. I love how Jesus reminds us here in this passage that He is always on mission for us. He is always proactive in His actions on our behalf. Look at this passage again. Look at verse 28. You have heard me tell you, I am going away, and I am coming to you. If you love me, you would rejoice that I am going to the Father, because the Father is greater than I. I have told you now before it happens, so that when it does happen, you will believe. I will not talk much longer, because the ruler of the world is coming, but he has no power over me. On the contrary, so that the world may know that I love the Father, I do as the Father has commanded me. Get up, let's leave this place. Where was he going? Where were they going when he left this place? When he left this place, he was going to the garden. That's where Judas would come and betray him. That would lead to him being led before the Sanhedrin, being judged before Pilate, being nailed to a cross. He was being proactive. He's saying to us that he goes. He's always on mission for you and me. And here's what the beautiful thing is. You say, oh, well, that happened 2,000 years ago. But let me just remind you of one very important reality. The scripture reminds us over and over again that he is our advocate. In Romans, the book of Romans, chapter 8, it tells us that daily he is making intercession for us. He is at the right hand of the Father, and on a daily basis, Jesus is being proactive for you. And he's praying for you every morning when you get up. Heavenly Father, watch over and put your name there. Heavenly Father, draw, put your name there, closer to you. Heavenly Father, put your name there. Allow the Holy Spirit to guide and to direct and to minister to put your name there so that they might be reminded that we've not forgotten them, that they might be reminded we are not being reactive. Remind them that we're being proactive. We're here before it ever happens. In fact, the scripture says that before God ever spoke one word of creation, he knew exactly what he would do for you, and he knew exactly what he would do for you today. And Jesus is saying and reminding us that he is proactive. I'm going for you. Jesus didn't have to go to the cross for himself. In fact, the only way that Jesus could go to the cross for me or for you as a result of his sinlessness, his perfection. He was without fault. He was without blame. He was without blemish. And that's the only reason he could go to the cross for us. And therefore, he reminds us that he is always working on our behalf. He is proactively guiding and praying for us so that we might be all that he wants us to be. And here's something else that we need to be reminded of today. Jesus, while he is being removed from the world so that the Spirit of God might come and reside within us, empower us, and dwell in us, he's reminding us that he's not removing us from this world, but rather he's empowering us to remove the world from us. Do I need to say that again? He's not removing us from the world, but the Holy Spirit, who empowers us, is empowering us to remove the world from us so that we might walk in his footsteps. We might walk by the Spirit so that we might be faithful to the peace that he has provided, that he gives, that he leaves for us. Paul reminds us that every day we must put on the gospel armor. Every day we must choose to put on and to walk in the Spirit and to leave behind the flesh. Jesus didn't come to take us out of the world, but to leave His peace with us in the world, that we might be His moon, allowing Him to shine, that we would be a reflection, just as the moon is a reflection of the great sun in the sky, that we would be a great reflection of the Son who rules and reigns at the right hand of the Father. How's your moon shining? Man, there was a beautiful full moon last night, early this morning. Beautiful. And you know what the world needs? The world needs us to be a full moon for Jesus. Just reflecting His light and His presence and His peace into the world that is struggling and stressed by brokenness. Jesus didn't promise to remove us from here, but He did promise to leave us a presence that would empower us so that the world did not have to control us and would not control us. So important for us to remember. But Jesus also reminds us that Satan's still at work. He still has influence, but he doesn't have power over Jesus. Praise the Lord. Greater is He that is in me than he that is in the world. Amen? But let me just tell you, the old devil, that old evil one, you know what he does? He seeks to rob us of our joy and God's joy that He gives to us. And you know what? He does it in the silliest and in the simplest ways. Like a battery that was green and ready to go when you tested it before you walked in the building, and it was red as a doorknob when you turned it on. It happens. And that's a silly illustration, but that's what he does. He seeks to rob us of our joy. And when David thought that he had captured the joy by going to be with Bathsheba and calling for her to be with him, it was not until he was confronted by the Lord. And then in Psalm 51, he cries out to the Lord, "Cleanse me, cleanse me, cleanse me, so that the joy, your joy, might return to me." And that's what the evil one seeks to do. He seeks to rob you of the joy of the Lord and God's peace that comes with that joy, that is the product of the Spirit and the fruit of the Spirit as it is at work. You know what else he does? He seeks to destroy your confidence in the Word of God and God's promise to you. Jesus said he's still at work. He's still influencing, just like he did back in the garden. What was it that he said to Eve? Did God really say for you not to eat from this tree? You know, there's a lot of folks today, they're hearing that in a different fashion. They're not hearing about eating from a tree. They're hearing, if God loved you, He'd let you do and be what you want to be. That's what they're hearing. God's saying, no, I created you for a purpose. I created you with a thought in mind. I created you with a plan to prosper you and to minister to you and to minister through you. And the evil one comes and he seeks to destroy our confidence in what God has said to us. He seeks to derail God's purpose for us. Jeremiah 29:11, you know it. "For I have a plan for you, to prosper you, not to do evil, but to do good for you and through you, so that you might pray for the peace of your city, and that you might bring peace to your city as you walk in my blessing and in my prosperity." And then we see that he seeks to discourage your enthusiasm. Enthusiasm, what is that? It comes from two words. In us, theos, God in us. He seeks to destroy our enthusiasm and to discourage our allowing God to live through us and in us for His honor and for His glory. But Jesus has a reminder to us, do not be dismayed. Do not let your heart be troubled or fearful. He reminds us that even in the midst of uncertainty, He is here to comfort us. He reminds us that even in the midst of the sorrows of life, He is there to address those needs. Even in the midst of our hearts being troubled, we can find peace because Jesus came to leave His peace. Peace that comforts the trouble and the fears of all life. He ministers to us through His peace and through His love for us. And then we'll not confront and we'll not address life the way that so many people do around us, that maybe some of us feel like from day to day. I just can't wait to go to heaven, and then all of this will be over. It's as if we think life is work. One of the men that worked for more than 30 years in the Augusta National Golf Club one day was asked the question, "How long have you worked here?" And without hesitating, he said with a delight in his voice, "I've logged 30 years here, but I haven't worked a day because I don't call this work." Have we embraced the peace that God brings to us so that we face life not as work, not as a day of work, but we log in every day knowing that today God has something for you and for me to do to make this world more like Jesus than it was before we started this day. Because He has left His peace, given His peace that brings down the walls of hostility and directs our path so that we might truly honor Him. Do you know Him? Have you embraced His peace? Do you know Him today? If not, I invite you to come by faith, because Jesus came not to buy your heart, but to win your heart so that you might know that He has bought your freedom and set you free from the cares of the world as He places His peace as His gift in all who believe. Let's stand together. Brother Jim is going to come and lead us in our hymn of decision. And this morning, if you have never admitted that you need a Savior because of your sin, today is your day. You come. Do you hear the Savior calling? He's calling you, calling your name. Maybe today as a believer, you know that God's direction and God's purpose for your life is to unite with this fellowship. And we invite you to come. Maybe the concerns of your heart lead you to say, "Brother Chuck, if I come, will you pray for me?" We're here to pray for you this morning. As we sing together, "You Come," just now. Receive the peace of the Lord.
We hope you have enjoyed this episode of Victory Baptist Worship. This is your personal invitation to visit us next week in person for worship on the Victory Baptist campus. To find weekly worship schedules, upcoming events, or to learn about better connecting with Victory Baptist Church, please visit vbcmtj.org today. Our prayer is that this week's message has helped you to grow in your walk with Christ. Thanks for joining us at Victory Baptist Worship on Roku.